Okay. Okay. Good morning, all. In last lecture, we have discussed about iron carbide equilibrium diagram. We have studied in that last lecture. We have discussed about the different phases which exists in the iron carbon phase diagram. And then different critical temperature lines, and after that we have completed the three transformation reactions. Now in this lecture, we are going to discuss about what is the meaning of the or what are the different types of the alloying elements. Already what is the meaning of alloying element that we have studied. Then we are going to discuss here the classification of the alloying elements on the different basis in respect to the steels. And after that we will see that what is the effect of different alloying elements when they are added in the steel. Means what kind of property changes will occur due to addition of the certain elements. That we are going to discuss here. The name of this point will be effect of the alloying elements on the steel. So before going for the actual effect of the alloying elements when they are added in the steel, first we should understand the classification of the alloying elements. And after understanding the classification of the different alloying elements, automatically you will be able to find out what will be their effect when they are added in the steel. So now, before starting this, first we will try to understand what is the difference between plain carbon steel and like the alloy steels. Okay, whichever iron carbon equilibrium diagram we have studied in the last lecture. 1 minute. Okay, this is the iron carbide equilibrium diagram, or it is also known as iron carbon equilibrium diagram or phase diagram. Now this diagram is drawn, or this diagram is plotted by considering it as a plain carbon steel. Now what is the plain carbon steel? Plain carbon steel, it is an alloy of the iron and carbon. Okay, here iron will be base metal and carbon will be alloying element. Now some other elements may present there, like some other elements may be there, but they will be present as the impurities, means some amount of sulfur, phosphorus will be there, but they are not added intentionally. They will be present, they will be in that particular kind of steel as if in the form of impurities. These are termed as the plain carbon steels. Okay, are you getting this? Alloys of iron and carbon, where iron will be parent metal or base metal and carbon will be alloying element, and some other elements may present there, like phosphorus, sulfur, manganese, like these different elements may be there, but they will be present in the form of impurities. They are not added intentionally to change the properties of that steel. That will be termed as the plain carbon steel. Now, what is the alloy steel? In this plain carbon steel, we are adding some other alloying elements, like suppose nickel, chromium, tungsten, molybdenum, different elements we are adding in the plain carbon steel to change the particular properties. Suppose you want to increase the hardness of that particular steel, then we are going to add chromium, vanadium or tungsten in that plain carbon steel. And that new steel which is formed, it will be termed as the alloy steel. Okay, in this in the alloy steel, it is again alloy of iron and carbon, but some other alloying elements may present there, like chromium, nickel, manganese, silicon, aluminium, tungsten, titanium, like that. Different elements may present there, which are added intentionally to change the properties according to our need or according to the desired application. That type of steels will be termed as the alloy steels. And this process, whichever concept we are discussing, this it will be termed as the concept of the alloying. Okay, so these are the plain carbon steels and alloy steels. Whichever iron carbon phase diagram we are studying, or it's shown in here in this slide, it is by considering, or it is for the plain carbon steel. And depending on the addition of the other alloying elements, there may be changes in this diagram. Okay, that's why for different steels diagram, this phase diagram will be different. This is for the plain carbon steel only. So what changes will occur after addition of other elements, other alloying elements, that we are going to discuss here under the title of effect of the alloying elements on the steel. Okay, now before going for actual effect, we will see the classification of the alloying elements. That will be the first point in our today's discussion. Now, classification of the alloying elements. Now, classification of the alloying elements is done in two different ways. That is, the effect of that alloying element when they are added in the steel with relation to the carbon. With relation to the carbon, according to that, three types of the alloying elements are there. First is the graphite forming elements. Second, graphitizing elements. So first is carbide forming element, second is graphitizing element, and third is the neutral element. Now we will see one by one. Carbide forming elements, when these certain elements, when added in the steel or added to the steel, they will form their respective carbides. Okay, when you are adding the tungsten or chromium, vanadium, they will form their respective carbides, and they will try to change the properties of that particular steel, or sometimes this process may occur in the cast iron also. So these elements which when added to the steel, they form their respective carbides, and they increases the hardness, wear resistance and corrosion resistance of that particular type of the steel. That elements will be termed as carbide forming elements. For example, titanium, zirconium, here I have mentioned some examples: titanium, zirconium, vanadium, niobium, tungsten, molybdenum, chromium, manganese, etc. Number of elements are there. When they are added in the steel, they will form their respective carbides, and they will change the properties like hardness. Here, due to formation of the carbide, hardness will get increased of that particular steel. And second type is graphitizing elements. Then what is the meaning of graphitizing elements? When certain elements are added in the steel, whichever carbides are already present in that steel, they will break that carbide and they will separate the carbon in the form of graphite. That's why means they decompose, they break that carbide and they will separate the carbon in the form of graphite. Graphite is nothing but the form of the carbon only. So these elements will be termed as graphitizing elements, means they will decompose the whichever carbides are present, they will break that and carbon will get separated. So these elements are termed as graphitizing elements. For example, silicon, nickel, copper, aluminium, number of examples are there, few examples I have mentioned here. So these are carbide forming elements and graphitizing elements. Now third type is neutral elements. What is the neutral elements? When these elements are added to the steel, they neither forms carbides nor they causes the graphitizing process. These elements will be termed as the neutral element, and there is only one neutral element, that is the cobalt. It does not have any effect related to the carbon, means neither it forms the carbides nor it causes the graphitization. You can say here is only one example, only one element which is neutral with relation to the carbon, that is the cobalt. So this is the classification of the alloying elements with respect to the relation with the carbon when they are added into the steel. Now the second classification is done on the basis of you can say that on the basis of their effect. When these elements are added, what effect they will cause on the temperature intervals in which allotropic forms of iron exists. Okay, here in these this classification is done on the basis of whatever effect they are causing on the critical temperature lines. In short, you can say that what is the effect of the addition of that element on the critical temperature lines, whether they are increasing the critical temperature, lowering the critical temperature, and due to increase or decrease in the particular critical temperatures, any one phase will get stabilized, or a range of that phase will get increased. Depending on that, alloying elements are classified in two types. austenite stabilizer and ferrite stabilizer. Okay, some elements or elements which when added to the steel, they will raise the A4 temperature and lowers the A3 temperature and increases the stability of the austenite phase. These kinds of elements will be termed as austenite stabilizer. For example, you can see that nickel, copper, then carbon, manganese, etc. Okay, then what next type is the ferrite stabilizer. I will explain these terms by referring to the iron carbon equilibrium diagram. Just try to understand this concept. I will repeat that with reference to the actual diagram. Elements which when added to the steel, they will lower the A4 temperature and they will raise the A3 temperature and increases the range of stability of the ferrite. These will be termed as the ferrite stabilizers. For example, you can say that titanium, boron, zircon, vanadium, niobium, etc. Number of elements are there. So now I will explain this with the reference to the actual iron carbon phase diagram. Okay, this is our iron carbon equilibrium diagram. Now, what are the austenitic stabilizer? Suppose one austenitic stabilizer you have added here, nickel or copper or carbon you have added, then what will be its effect? Now what it will do, this is your A4 temperature line. Okay, this is your A4 temperature line and this is the A3 temperature line. Now when austenite stabilizer elements are added, now this A3 temperature will be increased. Okay, this temperature will be increased and A4 temperature will be decreased. Means this whichever loop is there for austenite phase, it will become smaller, and as this A3 temperature is rising, this area means where alpha, that is ferrite phase, is present, the range of the ferrite phase will be in the increasing manner, or it will get increased. Are you getting this? Sorry, I have explained here for the ferrite stabilizer. I think when the ferrite stabilizers are added, like titanium, zirconium, like that, what will happen? This A4 temperature will be reduced and A3 temperature will get increased, and the stability for this alpha, that is the ferrite phase, will get increased. That will be termed as the ferrite stabilizer. And what is the austenite stabilizer? When austenite stabilizers are added, like a carbon, or you can say that nickel, what will happen? This A4 temperature increases and this A3 temperature falls. Okay, means the stability or range of austenite will get increased. Are you getting this? I will repeat it again. For austenite stabilizer, when these elements are added, A3 temperature decreases and A4 temperature increases, and the stability of austenite, the range of stability for this austenite or span of this austenite phase, expands. That will be termed as austenite stabilizer. Okay, when austenite stabilizer elements are added, this A3 temperature will drop, this A3 temperature will fall, and A4 temperature will increase. Due to that, what will happen? This range for this austenite phase will get expanded. That is austenite stabilizer elements. And when ferrite stabilizer elements are added, this A3 temperature increases and A4 temperature drops here, and range for stability of ferrite or span of that ferrite phase will get increased. That will be termed as ferrite stabilizer. Okay, are you understanding this? Please reply me. This is a little bit confusing. If you are having any problem, I will repeat it again. Okay, I will repeat it again. Okay, now what are the ferrite stabilizers and what are the austenite stabilizers? In short, what are the ferrite stabilizers? When these elements are added in the steel, it will stabilize the ferrite phase, means expansion of the ferrite phase will be there. Okay, now how the expansion of this ferrite phase, means here only we are having alpha, means there should be increase in the alpha region. When ferrite stabilizers are added, this A3 temperature, okay, I am highlighting here, A3 temperature will increase. A3 temperature will increase. Automatically, span for this ferrite region will get increased. Means A3 temperature will increase and A4 temperature will fall. Means span for ferrite will increase and span for austenite will get decreased. That's why it is termed as ferrite stabilizer. When these elements are added, they will increase A3 temperature and decrease A4 temperature, resulting in increase of span of ferrite phase and decrease in the span of austenite phase. That will be termed as ferrite stabilizer. And the next is the austenite stabilizer. When austenite stabilizers are added, they will lower this A3 temperature, means alpha region will get compressed. Okay, A3 temperature will get means there will be fall in the A3 temperature and there will be increase in this A4 temperature, means span of this austenite will get increased and span of ferrite will get decreased. Okay, means here stability of austenite will get increased or expanded, or its region will get expanded. That will be termed as austenite stabilizer. A3 temperature will get reduced and A4 temperature will get hike. Due to that, austenite region will get expanded. More austenite region will be there. That will be termed as austenite stabilizers. Okay, is it clear now? Okay, now there are two different I have added that slide in the note that I will explain here only. Now what will happen when ferrite stabilizers are added, then ferrite phase will get means span of that ferrite phase is increasing, and a certain stage will come in a particular kind of steels where from room temperature up to the melting point only ferrite phase is there. Okay, due to addition of that ferrite stabilizer elements, what will happen in that steel from room temperature, from this temperature up to the melting point, only one phase, that is ferrite phase, is there. Only one phase, ferrite phase will be there. That type of steel will be termed as ferritic steels. Okay, in the steels in which from room temperature up to melting point only one phase, that is ferrite phase, is present. Okay, are you getting this? Ferrite phase will be there, only one phase. That steels will be termed as ferritic steels. And in the same way, there are some types of the steels in which due to addition of the austenite stabilizers from room temperature up to their melting point, only austenite phase will be there. Only austenite phase will be there. I am highlighting here. Only austenite. From room temperature up to melting point, only austenite, that is single phase austenite, will be there. It will be termed as austenitic steels. Okay, these are austenitic steels. Are you getting this? Ferritic steels and austenitic steels. In ferritic steels, from room temperature up to melting point, only single phase, that is ferrite, is present. That will be termed as ferritic steels. And in some kind of the steel, due to addition of austenite stabilizer elements from room temperature up to the melting point, only austenite phase is present. That kind of steel is termed as the austenitic steels. Is it clear? What is the meaning of ferritic steel and austenitic steels? Please give me reply.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And we will move forward. So this is the classification of the alloying elements. Yeah, this is the classification of the alloying element. We have discussed about this, depending on the relation of that alloying element with the carbon and their effect on the different phases which exist in the iron carbon equilibrium diagram, that is austenite stabilizer and ferrite stabilizer. And after seeing this, we will move towards the actual effect. What are the different effects caused due to the addition of the alloying elements? Some common effects I have highlighted here. Some 7 to 8 effects are there due to addition of the alloying elements. These are common effects. What are the specific effects which will due to addition of, suppose we have added only vanadium, what will be change in the properties or what kind of changes will occur in that particular kind of steel? That we will discuss in the next lecture. In this lecture, we will see some common effect, what will happen due to addition of the alloying elements. For that, this also I have discussed, that is austenitic steels and ferritic steels. Now, some common effects are there. Some alloying elements may cause one or more of the following elements, effects. The first effect. So for this point also, I will tell you that I have referred on the book of V.D. Kodagiri. Same points will be there. You will find same points there as it is. I have just referred that book only. You can refer it also. And I will send you the presentation and notes also through that study material link. You can check it. Now, we will go towards this point. Effect of the alloying elements on the steels. Some common effects are there. First effect is the formation of the carbides. Okay. Already we have discussed during the types of the alloying elements or classification of the alloying elements, depending on the their relation with the carbon. Some alloying elements which when added to the steel, they will form their respective carbides. Okay. And due to the formation of these carbides, now this whichever carbides are formed, this carbide is hard phase, and it is stronger phase. It will increase the wear resistance and abrasion resistance of that steel. Okay, it will increase the wear resistance, abrasion resistance, or also it will increase the resistance to the tempering. Tempering is nothing but the softening of the steels at the higher temperatures. Whenever you are heating a particular steel, it will become soft at higher temperatures, above 700, 800, 900 degrees Celsius. It will become somewhat soft, but due to formation of the carbide, the resistance for that softening process also increases. Why it is increasing? As we are adding some alloying elements, they will form the carbides. Suppose tungsten is added, tungsten carbide is there. It will increase the hardness because it is very hard phase. And it also increases the wear resistance and abrasion resistance of that particular steel. Now here, in this carbide forming, whichever carbide forming elements are there, out of that, chromium carbides and vanadium carbides, which are formed, these are having maximum hardness. Okay. They are having very high hardness, sometimes due to formation of these chromium or vanadium carbide, sometimes material may become brittle also, due to small shock it may get break. That's why we have to take proper care, so that we have to add limited amount of chromium or vanadium. Suppose its quantity we are adding beyond the limit, then it may create brittleness also. Okay, so this is the first effect, that is whenever some carbide alloying elements are added, they will form their respective carbides. And as carbides are harder and stronger in nature, they will increase the hardness, then wear resistance and abrasion resistance of the steel. And also they will increase the resistance of that steel material to the tempering or softening. Now here, chromium and vanadium are the most effective elements, most effective in the sense they will increase the hardness in the more value or more amount. Okay, some examples you can write here, all the examples of carbide forming elements you can add here, that examples: titanium, zirconium, vanadium, then tungsten, etc. Then the next common effect of the alloying addition of the alloying element in the steel is formation of the intermediate compound. Now, whenever some alloying elements when added, they will form along with the carbide formation, some intermediate compound formation will be there, and these intermediate compounds will be formed with the iron. Carbides are formed with the reaction taking place with the carbon. Okay, whenever alloying elements are added, they react with the carbon and they will form the respective carbides. And when that particular alloying element react with the iron, they will form some complex or intermediate compounds with the iron. Now, whenever this formation of intermediate compounds or complex compounds with the iron takes place, these will increase the brittleness of that material. Instead of making the material stronger, they will make the material weak, in the sense that it will decrease the shock resistance of that material. Due to formation of the intermediate compound, that material will become brittle and its shock resistance will goes on decreasing. Means with little shock, that material will get breaked. Okay, means the formation of the intermediate compound is not desirable. Formation of the carbides is desirable as far as it is controlled. Means formation of the carbide will result in the superior properties in the sense of strength, hardness, wear resistance and abrasion resistance. But formation of the intermediate compounds, due to formation of the intermediate compounds or complex compounds, they will increase the brittleness of the material, and due to the increase in the brittleness, whenever that material faces a small shock also, it will get breaked. Okay, means formation of intermediate compounds, it is not desirable, and formation of the carbides is desirable, at it improves the properties of the steel. Okay, so these are the first two effects. The next effect is third effect, is formation of the inclusion. Okay, now what is the meaning of the inclusion? When some alloying elements are added, suppose a chromium element is there or aluminium element is there, they will react with the oxygen which is present in the surrounding, and they will form the respective oxides, and they will form a thin layer of that oxide on that particular steel material. Due to that, what will happen? It will increase the oxidation and corrosion resistance of that particular kind of steel. So this is the third effect. When some elements, suppose we are adding chromium, aluminium, they will form the respective oxide, chromium oxide, aluminium oxide. A thin film will be formed on the surface of that steel. Due to that thin film, oxidation and corrosion resistance will get improved. Again, the formation of inclusion is also desirable in some cases. Okay, means as far as it is favorable, as far as it is increasing the oxidation resistance and corrosion resistance, it is desirable. The third point in this is lowering of the critical cooling rate. Now here, in short, lowering of the critical cooling rate means, to understand this point clearly, you have to complete the second and the third chapter. In that only you can understand what is the meaning of critical cooling rate. Now here, in simple way to understand this, I will repeat this point in the second and third chapter also, but try to understand here what is the importance of this. Means whenever alloying elements are added, it will lower the critical cooling rate. In short, I will tell you that you have to choose the faster cooling rates from the, whenever you are heating the material from or any alloy from room temperature to the liquid state, and you want to change its some properties. Suppose you want to increase the hardness. Here, suppose this specifically is useful in increasing the hardness or hardenability of a material. Now, how it is useful? You have to select the faster cooling rates. Okay, you have to choose whenever addition of alloying elements is there, you have to choose the more faster cooling rate to get the higher hardness. Okay, to get the higher hardness, that is the effect of the alloying elements. You have to, means it will shift that IT diagram, that is isothermal transformation diagram, is there. So leave that part that we will discuss later. Just try to understand that whenever addition of alloying element increases, you have to choose faster cooling rate to improve the properties like hardness and strength of that particular alloy or that particular steel. So this is the effect of the alloying element on the steel. Lowering of the critical cooling rate means you have to choose the faster cooling rate. You have to cool that alloy from liquid state up to the solid state with very faster rate or with minimum time, so that you will get the better hardness and better strength. For example, you can write manganese, molybdenum, chromium like this. These are most effective elements. What is the meaning of most effective? Very small addition of these elements also small addition results in the you have to choose with, if you have added small amount of chromium or manganese, you have to choose the faster cooling rates. Okay, means you have to do the cooling in minimum possible time. That is the effect of the addition of the alloying elements on the critical cooling rate. Then next effect is now this is the fifth effect, that is the shifting of critical temperatures and shifting of eutectoid carbon. Now this is taken from the with reference to the iron carbon equilibrium diagram. In the iron carbon equilibrium diagram, first I will explain you what is the eutectoid temperature and what is the eutectoid composition. What is the effect of addition of the alloying element on eutectoid temperature and eutectoid composition? First I will explain you what is the meaning of eutectoid temperature and eutectoid composition with reference to this iron carbon equilibrium diagram. So this is our iron carbon equilibrium diagram. Now here you can see clearly at this point E at 727 degrees Celsius, eutectoid transformation occurs. Okay, this particular temperature indicated by point E or this horizontal line, this 727 degrees Celsius temperature is eutectoid temperature, and its corresponding composition, the point at which eutectoid transformation is occurring, that is 0.8% carbon. This is your eutectoid composition for iron carbon equilibrium diagram. Okay, this 0.8% carbon is eutectoid composition, and the 727 degrees Celsius temperature is eutectoid temperature. Now what is the effect of addition of the alloying elements on this eutectoid temperature and eutectoid composition? Here it is shown. Okay, whenever here at the top diagram, here two parts are there. This top diagram, it will indicate the effect of alloying element on the eutectoid temperature, and this bottom diagram will indicate the effect of alloying element on the eutectoid carbon or eutectoid composition. Okay, now I will first explain the eutectoid composition because it is simple. Whichever alloying element you are adding, whichever alloying element you are adding to the steel or plain carbon steel, it will lower the composition. It may be austenite stabilizer or it may be ferrite stabilizer. Whichever alloying element you are adding, okay, you may add ferrite stabilizer or austenite stabilizer, it will lower the composition. 0.8, if suppose you have added the titanium, and it will lower the composition up to 0.2. okay, suppose if you have added the nickel, it can also lower this composition. Okay, whichever alloying element you are adding, eutectoid composition, that is 0.8% carbon, it will get decreased to 0.6, 0.4 or 0.2, depending on the quantity of added alloying element. Okay, depending on the quantity of the added alloying element. But the common effect is whenever alloying elements are added in the plain carbon steel, eutectoid composition or eutectoid carbon percentage, it will get decreased from, or it will get decreased below 0.8% carbon. Okay, this is the effect of alloying element on the eutectoid composition. Now what is the effect of alloying element on the eutectoid temperature? Now here from this diagram you are seeing that some alloying elements are decreasing the temperature and some alloying elements are increasing the temperature. Okay. Due to addition of some alloying elements, eutectoid temperature is increasing, and due to addition of some alloying elements, eutectoid temperature is decreasing. Now, how you are going to identify the effect? Now, whichever austenite stabilizers are there, when they are added in the steel, they will decrease the eutectoid temperature. Okay, are you getting this? They will decrease the eutectoid temperature when austenite stabilizer is added. As whenever addition, austenite stabilizer means, okay, I will take first, I will explain here and I will move towards the iron carbon equilibrium diagram. Okay, when austenite stabilizers are added, they will lower the eutectoid temperature. Lower the eutectoid temperature means, you have seen what is the austenite stabilizer, they will lower the A3 temperature. A3 temperature, as A3 temperature is lowering, automatically eutectoid temperature will get lower. Okay, and when ferrite stabilizer elements are added, eutectoid temperature increases. Okay, now I will repeat the same part with a reference to iron carbon equilibrium diagram. Okay, when austenite stabilizers are added, it decreases the eutectoid temperature. When austenite stabilizer is added, this austenite loop or gamma loop will get expanded, means this temperature will fall. Okay, in simple way, when austenite stabilizers are added, as gamma phase is having more region, this temperature, this horizontal line will fall. Okay, that is eutectoid temperature will get decreased. And when ferrite stabilizer is added, you have to increase this alpha region, means this line will move in the upward, A3 will move in the upward manner, means automatically this eutectoid temperature increases. Okay, are you getting this? If you are having any query, you can ask me. Whether it is clear, please reply me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, then we will move towards next point. Okay, I will repeat this part again. Whenever alloying elements are added in this steel, it may be austenite stabilizer or ferrite stabilizer, they decreases the eutectoid composition. And whenever ferrite stabilizers are added, they increases the temperature, eutectoid temperature, and austenite stabilizer decreases the eutectoid temperature. So next effect, we will move towards next effect, is solid solution strengthening or solid solution hardening. Now, what is this solid solution strengthening or solid solution hardening? Now, whenever alloying elements are added in the steel, almost all the alloying elements which we are adding in the steel, they are able to dissolve in the iron, and they will form the solid solution with the iron. And these solid solution formation, whichever respective solid solutions will be formed, when chromium is added, it will form its respective solid solution with the iron. Tungsten will form solid solution with the iron. These formation of solid solution will occur, and we have already studied that as compared to the pure metal, solid solution formed is having more strength and hardness. Okay, due to this, automatically strength and hardness of that particular alloy will get increased. This effect is termed as the solid solution strengthening or solid solution hardening, due to formation, which I will repeat it again, when alloying elements are added in the steel, they get dissolved in the iron by forming respective solid solutions, and these solid solutions are having more hardness and more stronger in nature, or having more strength as compared to the pure metal. Due to that, it will increase the hardness and strength of that alloy. That's why this effect is termed as solid solution strengthening or solid solution hardening. Now, in this diagram, we have shown the effect of, on the x-axis, concentration or percentage of alloying element is there. On y-axis, hardness is plotted. As here, you can see that as percentage of the alloying element is increasing, hardness also increases. But for some elements like phosphorus, silicon, manganese, the addition of small amount increases the hardness in the higher amount. So these are the most effective elements or most effective solid solution strengtheners or hardeners: phosphorus, silicon, and manganese. Okay. This is the solid solution strengthening. We will move towards the next effect. Okay. The next effect is the increase in, due to addition of some alloying elements, there is increase in the corrosion resistance and oxidation resistance of the steel. Why it is occurring? Now, whichever effects already I have explained, depending on that only, these effects will occur. That is, first effect is corrosion and oxidation resistance. Now, whenever alloying elements are added, generally there is improvement or increase in the oxidation resistance and corrosion resistance. Why corrosion resistance and oxidation resistance increases? Due to formation of the inclusions. We have studied that. That is, due to formation of the inclusions means, suppose chromium, it will react with the oxygen to form chromium oxide, aluminium forms aluminium oxide. Due to formation of these oxide layers, a thin film will get formed on the surface of that steel, and due to that, the corrosion resistance and oxidation resistance of that particular steel will get improved. Okay. Then next is the creep strength and fatigue strength. Creep strength and fatigue strength, whenever you are adding the alloying element in the steel, creep strength and fatigue strength of that particular steel material increases due to formation of the carbide particles or carbide materials. Whenever alloying element is added, they will form their respective carbides, and as these respective carbides are having harder and stronger in nature, they will increase the creep strength and fatigue strength. What is the creep strength and fatigue strength? Fatigue strength is a strength or a resistance provided for the cyclic loading, and creep strength is the resistance provided for a constant load for a definite period of time. That is termed as, and the resistance provided for that deformation is termed as the creep resistance, and that creep strength is increasing here. If fatigue strength means in cyclic loading will be there, and due to that cycling loading, it is some deformation may occur or stress will get created, and a resistance provided to that, it will be termed as fatigue resistance, and that will be that strength increases. Or that resistance increases due to formation of the carbide particles. So that this is the effect. It increases the creep strength and fatigue strength. Now the last effect of the addition of the alloying element. Due to addition of the alloying elements, depending on their percentage, here you can see in the diagram, there will be volume changes. Okay, whenever we are cooling on any alloy from liquid phase to the room temperature, some changes or phase changes will occur. During that phase change, how much will be the volume change depending on the quantity of the alloying element, that is shown in this diagram. Okay, depending on the volume changes, you have to select the addition or quantity of that element. Why it is important? Whenever volume change is high, suppose these top two elements are there. This top is the chromium. Suppose chromium or nickel is there. Whenever their percentage is more, or volume changes will occur in more amount whenever percentage of the chromium or nickel is more. Okay, and as volume change is more during cooling, chances of distortion and cracking are more. Okay, that's why this volume change is important. You have to select the percentage of that element depending on the volume changes they are creating. If volume change is more during the cooling process, distortion and cracking will be more. Okay, distortion and cracking will occur in more quantity, and the failure of that material will take place. That's why you have to choose this percentage of the alloying element carefully by considering their effect on the volume transformation. Okay, considering their effect. Okay, whenever higher volume changes are there, it will cause more distortion, or it will increase the risk of cracking whenever you are doing the hardening process by doing the quenching. Quenching means nothing but, for your understanding, you are doing the cooling here, faster cooling. Faster cooling, that process will be termed as the quenching process. Okay, so whenever volume changes are more due to addition of certain alloying elements, then distortion and cracking chances are more. That's why you have to select the percentage of the alloying elements carefully, so that there should be minimum distortion and minimum cracking during the hardening process or during the cooling process. So this is also the effect of the addition of the alloying elements. Okay, here it is shown that as you are doing the addition of the alloying elements, it increases. Some alloying elements will increase the volume change, or some alloying element will decrease the volume change. Here this silicon, it is decreasing the volume change. As its percentage is increasing, volume change is lesser. Means chances of cracking or distortion is less with the increasing the amount of silicon. But whenever you are increasing this element, suppose this and this, nickel and chromium, you are increasing the amount of this element, this is the chromium, then volume changes is more. Volume changes are also increasing, means it is causing, it will cause more distortion and cracking during the cooling, means chances of cracking are more here. Okay, so this is the effect, and by considering this effect, you have to choose the percentage of that element, so that there should be minimum distortion and minimum cracking. Okay, if you are having any difficulty, please ask me. In this way, we have completed this part, that is, I'll repeat this, classification of the alloying element. First, we have seen that classification of the alloying elements in two different ways with relationship with the carbon, three types, carbide forming, graphitizing and neutral elements, then their effect on the different phases of which are existing in the iron carbon equilibrium diagram as austenite stabilizer and ferrite stabilizer. And depending on this stabilizer type, two special types of steels are there: austenitic steels having austenite phase only, ferritic steels having ferrite phase only. Then effect of the alloying elements on the steel. First effect, formation of the carbides, then formation of the intermediate compounds, then formation of inclusions, then effect on the selection of the cooling rates, then effect on the eutectoid temperature and eutectoid composition, then solid solution strengthening, then effect on the corrosion resistance, oxidation resistance, and then creep strength and fatigue strength of that steel. And after that, what will be the changes in the volume during the transformation or change in the phase due to addition of that alloying element, that we have discussed. In this way, we have discussed in this lecture what is the effect, what are the different types of the alloying elements with in the steel, related to the steel, and what will be the effect of the alloying element when they are added to the steel. Okay, if you are having any difficulty, you can ask me. Otherwise, I will stop here and put that in the chat box. If you are having any difficulty, you can put that in the chat box, or if all points are clear, you can put that also in the chat box. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the classification of the plain carbon steel and the whichever particular, what will be the effect of adding the particular element, particular alloying element, how it will change or which properties will get changed of the steel, that we will see in the next lecture, along with the classification of the plain carbon steels. Is it clear, all points in this lectures? Have you understood it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Regarding that video lecture links, I will add that video lecture links within one day. I will add that for all lectures. For starting 3 or 4 lectures, I was not able to record the lecture at that time. After that, I have recorded all the lectures. I will add that links in that study material. Okay. Now I will stop here. Thank you.